Richard, have fun there. Well, folks, here we are again at Hemet Valley RV and Siding in Hemet, California. And we're about to do something that we haven't done yet. Well, he's done it, but I haven't showed it to you. And we are making a run on a piece of metal here for a 59 Forester for my buddy Jim in Steamboat Springs, Colorado. And I wanted to show it on video because I haven't shown this type of run yet. What we have is a run that's going, I don't even know what you call this. Do you have a name for this?
Yeah, it's called the Larry Run.
The Larry Run. There you go. It's the Larry Run. But basically, it's a 4-inch break, and then if you were to move it all over 5/8 of an inch and run it through with another 4-inch break, that's what you've got. So you've basically got 3 3/8 inch break, and then a 5/8 inch break smaller, and then a 3 3/8 inch break. And we're going to show you some of the different types of metal, but the different types of runs that they do here after we get done with this one. So let's go ahead and get on with it. And Jim, this is for you. Just ran it with the 4-inch brakes. And now what we're going to attempt to do is we're going to attempt to run that through again, moved over 5/8 of an inch.
Okay, basically, do me a favor. I say,
there it is. We did it. Yeah. Hi, Larry here with Mobile Tech, and I'm here with Steve Loomis at Hemet Valley RV again.
Hi, Larry. How you doing?
Real good.
Good.
It looks like you're doing good, too. First of all, one of the things I wanted to let you know is that Steve is now offering J-Rail. You know how hard it is to get this stuff. He's offering it now.
Actually, we're calling it Vintage Drip Rail on our website, and it's new, and we just did a blog about it, but it's taken us a couple years to find this product. And now that we found it, we have plenty in stock, and a 16-foot length of it is $25.
That's great. And you can ship it in the full 16-foot length?
Absolutely. If you need it in the full 16-foot length, it will be extreme length with any LTL freight company, but we can cut it in half and it'll go FedEx ground.
Okay, great. Now, what I wanted to show you was every time I come here, Steve educates me, and in turn, we like to educate you people. That's what these videos are all about. So he's going to tell us a little bit about the vintage metal, the difference in the types of seams and brakes right now, and some of the things that he offers. As you know, also, Steve is now doing up to 14-foot lengths of 6-inch brakes. So for all you people that didn't think you could find anybody to do 6-inch brakes, Steve is now offering them.
Yeah, we can do 5-inch run, 6-inch run, any run you want now, because we have recently purchased a 14-foot handbrake, and we don't have the ability to run through a roll form machine, but we can do it by hand, and our guys are very good at getting equal brakes on each one, so it looks like a roll form machine.
And you saw it on the Shasta when I did that, so it comes out really nice and perfect. So, all right, now Steve's going to go ahead and run us through a little bit of this. I'm going to grab the camera. All right, Steve, why don't you tell us about the different types of locks that we have here.
Well, Larry, back in the 50s and 60s, they only had what was called a Pittsburgh lock. And you will see here that there is a little mesa hump that is formed before it tucks into its S-lock. That became obsolete in the late 70s, early 80s, when the S-lock was came about, because it's a smoother, more sleek look. If you're going to do a complete trailer, I would recommend to go to the S-lock. It gives it a better look, and it also matches better with either the 4-inch or 3-inch run or the 5 or 6-inch run patterns, because it looks just like another line in the system rather than botching it up with one of these Pittsburgh locks. But if you're just going to replace maybe one or two pieces on a trailer and the unit already has Pittsburgh lock on it, we do have the capabilities of providing a Pittsburgh lock with the OEM look.
That's great. And you know, one of the big deals about this is that our seams normally go right through the window holes. And so as a result, when you go to put your windows back in, you got to put a whole lot of extra putty tape on there to fill in so that you don't have a leak going into the window here. If this is the edge, look at how big that bump is. So you've got to double up your putty tape going around there. Whereas when you have this S-lock, it's so much smoother, and you're probably only going to have to use a single strip of putty tape.
Yep, you're right, Larry.
Now let's move on to some of the later stuff in the 70s and whatever, where we have these Mesa Deluxe. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that, Steve?
Well, when the RV industry first started, everybody was using your 3, 4, 5, 6-inch run patterns. As the trailers became longer, it became necessary to add more lines to the metal to prevent heat expansion. And this was a very popular pattern that came out in the 70s called 2-inch Mesa Deluxe. And it's got a nice wide 1¾-2-inch hump with 5 lines in the valley. As they found, as the trailers even got larger, that was even starting to wave in the heat. So they came up with 2-inch custom Mesa that has an upscore line in the middle. You'll find these two patterns very popular back in the 70s. As things kept on progressing, coaches got larger and larger. Yoder pattern was very popular to combat heat expansion. But as you can see, it's very roly-poly, and you cannot install graphics on it very easily, and it's not a smooth look. So they continued to evolve, and they started coming out with 1-inch Mesa Deluxe, which now, instead of repeating every 4 inches, repeats every 3 inches. And now the latest pattern that is the most popular with everybody is the 1-inch custom Mesa. And there's an upscore in the Mesa hump, and there's a full 3 lines in the valley. Repeats every 3 inches. And all your major manufacturers use that pattern exclusively now, because the vinyl graphics have gotten so large, and you need a smooth pattern in order to be able to install the graphics.
Well, that's just great. I sure appreciate you helping us out with that, Steve. So with that, I'm going to get this order that we just ran together and loaded up in my truck. And I'm off to Colorado with your material.
Happy travels.
Thank you very much, Steve.
All right. Take care.
This trailer has been sitting here for many, many years. Steve Loomis told me that he used to, he lives near here. Says he's passed this many times on his way to work, and told me to come over and take a look. And it's sitting in somebody's yard. There's another one I'll be looking at too that's been sitting there for many, many years since he was a kid going to high school, and it's still there. And a lot of people have asked me, where do you find your trailers? Well, I can tell you that I don't find them on Craigslist and I don't find them on eBay. This is how I find them. Either people tell me about them, or I happen to be passing by somewhere and I see it myself. I find them in people's yards. I don't bother with Craigslist. I don't bother with eBay for the most part. I keep an eye on them, but that's not where I find most of my trailers. So I see one like this, I ring the doorbell, and I ask them if they would like to sell it. Most of the time they say no. Sometimes they say yes. Well, nobody's answering the doorbell, and I won't walk through their gate even if it's unlocked. I don't know if it is or not. But this looks like it's either a Nomad or an Oasis because of the shape. And my eyes aren't good enough to see what's written on it, but nobody's answering the gate. Maybe I'll try again someday. But this is how I find my trailers. Now, I found this trailer just a few blocks away, and it's been sitting here for at least since the 60s, because Steve Loomis said that he used to ride by this trailer every day on his bicycle on his way to high school. So this one's been here a long time, and I just talked to the owner. Her name is Jeanette Boe, B-O-E, and this trailer is not for sale and probably never will be. Her grandfather owned it, and she appears to be probably a good 10 to 15 years older than I am, and I'm 60. So she just gave me the history of this trailer, and I will bring Jeanette and the trailer to you at a later date, because right now I don't have the time. But I'm going to stop by, and I'm going to help her out with a few things on the trailer for free that she needs looked at. And I offered my services for free just so that I could get the history and a few photographs and be able to tell you about this beautiful little trailer that's been in her family for three generations now, on its way to its fourth generation. So I don't even know what kind it is, and she doesn't remember the name either, but next time, she says she has the paperwork, and next time I come out here, we'll find that all out, and we'll do a tour of the inside of the trailer. She says that her grandmother used to live in this trailer while they were building their house. Isn't that something? Just amazing. I figure it's a late 40s. I don't know, I can't tell from out here what kind it is. It has no tags on it that are visible, no printing on it that's visible. But she says it's all birch inside, it's all wood, and it's been very well taken care of. So that will be a treat for an upcoming video in the future. And it's going to be the near future. Probably as soon as I get back from Colorado, I'm gonna look her up again. I gave her my card for Can-Am Trailers, and I told her I will help her out with anything she needs done to this trailer for free, just so that I can get the history. She has photographs of her grandparents with the trailer. That is going to be something to see. So we'll be looking for that when I get back from Colorado. Isn't that pretty? Those are original blinds that her grandfather put in there, from what she says. You can see the blinds through the windows. Isn't it gorgeous? And again, this is how I find my trailers. Either somebody tells me about one they've seen, or I spot it. And like I say, most of the time when I knock on the door, I either don't get an answer to the door, or it's not for sale. And when I knocked on Jeanette's door, she told me that, I said, I know that probably hundreds of people have come here and bug you like I'm bugging you now, but would you mind talking to me for a little bit about the trailer? And she was gracious enough to come out here and give me the history of the trailer. And I really appreciate that, Jeanette. Thank you so much. So like I say, we'll be back, and we'll get a tour of this trailer, and I'm gonna help her with anything that she needs done to the trailer. She says that she is worried that she may have to move it just because she gets bugged so much about it. So I told her to put a sign out front that says not for sale, but you may take pictures. So maybe she won't get bugged so much. I know, we have to do it, don't we? It's in our nature. Us trailerites are just like that. Larry from Mobile Tech, Can-Am Trailers, signing off. You just stay right there. Okay. You go ahead and come up with the clapboards.
Yeah. Take two.
Hi, Larry here with Mobile Tech, and we're back with Steve Loomis from Hemet Valley So we've got to do it again.
It's like the real deal, bloopers and all.
Take three.
Yeah, Hemet Valley RV, Larry.
Hemet Valley RV. The RV went away.
Oh, you got two on us, so.
Now this is take two.
This is take two. Okay, yeah, okay. Come on over. We're running right now.
Take two.
So you've got to double up your putty tape going around there. Whereas when you have this S-lock, it's so much smoother, and you're probably only going to have to use a single strip of putty tape.
Yep, you're right, Larry.
Now let's move on to some of the later stuff in the 70s and whatever, where we have these Mesa Deluxe. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that, Steve?
Well, as the trailers got larger, they found that heat expansion happens when metal is installed in 40 degree weather and then it's exposed to over 100 degree weather, the aluminum grows. And so the people that were the innovators in all of this found that they started having to add lines to the metal to make it